Hi everyone, thank you for being interested in my talk. Today I'm going to talk about an optimal control problem, and more precisely, a reformulation of an optimal control problem using some states or variables. This is a work performed by me with Charles Audet and Luc Bourdin, respectively a professor in black box optimization in Polytechnique Montréal in Gérard, and in optimal control in the University of Limoges in France. So this work is at the intersection of these two fields. Before going into the heart of the topic, I will start with a preliminary section discussing a generic optimization problem, because the optimal control is a specific case of a generic optimization problem. So first of all, in detail, why do we need a preliminary section? Well, we aim optimal control problems with singularities on it, but located singularities. That is, only some of the variables are affecting those. All the others has no impact on these singularities. So the objective of the talk, the main idea we'll talk about, is to separate these variables from the others and address those in a very specific manner. So in this preliminary section, I will show the ID on the generic optimization problem. And after that, the optimal control will be a specific case of this general discussion. So let's start with a generic optimization problem of this form. This is a well-known problem. We aim to minimize a nonlinear function phi affected by some constraints. We aim to reformulate it in this following manner. We separate the variable x into two sets, y and z, and the problem p becomes some kind of bi-level problem that I noted r, which consists to minimize y at the upper level as a non-constrained problem, and the lower level becomes the optimization over z with y already fixed by the upper level. You may notice that I wrote the subproblem as an infimum rather than a minimum for a reason that I will explain later. You can also notice that this problem depends on a subproblem that I will write formally in that way. So we have a subproblem with where y is an input, so it is fixed in the problem, and v is the only variables. This subproblem is non-trivial. I will not explain in details all the theoretical problem it has, but I will show some examples. First of all, the most important thing is the subproblem may have no minimum. If you pick a very simple example, that is phi equal this, well, you can solve p easily. If you wish to minimize this, just bring y equals 0 and z is free. But if you try to solve the subproblem with y already fixed, the only variables you have is z, and then if y is non-zero, then this problem has no minimum. So it is not that easy to solve. However, you can note that if y is optimal, that is if y equals 0, then this problem is trivially solved and you have an optimal solution. So in general, s may have no minimum. This is the most important problem we'll have to deal with. But you can also have some other tricky aspects, like this problem may be infeasible. We won't discuss the example just here if you have questions, but recall that for certain inputs y, this problem may be infeasible. That is, there is no z such that the constraint is satisfied. Finally, there is another kind of problem, this time we're affecting R rather than this problem. Main thing is R may have more optima than P because of this subproblem. Look at the following example. The objective function phi is defined that way. You can see that it is always positive, and you can reach the value 0 with y equals z equals 0. So P has an optimal solution. Trivially, 0, 0. However, if you transform P into R, you get two optimal solutions. The first one is y equals 0, And that way, you remove this term, you have objective, you aim to minimize z square. So you have an optimal solution for this problem, zero. However, you also have an optimal solution for r, which is y equal one. You remove this term, but this time you recover this, and this problem has no minimum. So as you can see, even if the original problem has one optimal solution, R may have more than one optimal solution, and only one of these optima can be used to recover the original problem, the solution of the original problem. So R is not trivial to use, but it is still interesting because some of its optima solve the original problem. So in a sense, you have some equivalence results that are given here in this theorem. I won't discuss the whole theorem in details. Again, it's for question, but the main idea is if you start from an optimal solution of B, you can trivially find an optimal solution of R and an optimal solution of the subproblem. In the same way, it is actually an equivalence result in the sense that if you find an optimal solution of R, Y star, such that the subproblem also has an optimal solution, Z star, then you can aggregate these two optimal solutions as X star, which is actually an optimal solution of B. So in a sense, solving R is relevant because you can recover an optimal solution of your initial problem from the reformulation. So okay, long story short, if you have to remind something from this preliminary section, just recall that R separates some variables of P from the others in a bi-level structure where some predefined variables are at the upper level and the other one are left to this problem at the lower level. This becomes interesting when P has singularities affected by only some of the variables. If you know the variables which has singularities, just bring them to the upper level, and then the lower level becomes smooth. So it is easily solved, and you have removed the singularities you have removed this small number of variables which affect singularities to a very smaller problem, which is, by the way, easier to solve. So this is the idea on the generic optimization problem. It does not sound that good, but as you will see, in some structure problem, it performs well. So here we go for an optimal control problem. I don't know how familiar you are with the topic, so I will give us an informal idea of what is an optimal control problem. In general, you have a physical system with a dynamic. Here I give you a very simple example, which is an harmonic oscillator. So you have a spring stick with a mass, and everything moves due to the physical law with this differential equation. We aim a control function, in this example, an external force, such that the trajectory resulting from this control has some optimal properties. Well, according to a certain criteria, which depends on the problem. You can think about, for example, stabilizing the system with minimal action from the control. So if I have to give, an informal information, the optimal control field consists of optimizing inputs of a differential equation such that the solution of this equation has optimal properties according to a certain criteria. So if we aim to formalize this, we start with a certain time span discretized over a certain number of steps, and we consider all the discrete times of the time span. We start from an initial state x0 at the initial time t0. And we have some certain discrete dynamics written as this equation, where, long story short, the incoming states depend on the current state and the current control. Everything is pushed into a dynamic function, which gives how the system evolves knowing its current state and its current control you apply on it. In terms of simplicity, I will just write an additional notation. For a certain state x and a certain control u, I will write x of u as the trajectory resulting from applying u from the state x. As you can see here, at the initial time, x of u equals x. And after that, x of u at time ki plus 1 is the resulting trajectory coming from the application of uk from the state xu of k after t. Okay, so this will be useful to write the problem properly after that. Moreover, we can have some constraints affecting the problem. We have two separate set of constraints, one at the final time affected by the final state only, cn of xn negative, plus for each, let's say, intermediate time, a constraint affected by xk and uk. This is useful to create some connection between u and x, for example. And finally, we also need an objective function, which is defined according to two performance criteria. Usually in optimal control, you have some Lagrange cost defined at each tk and depends on the current state and the current control. You also have one Meyer cost, which is a cost defined for the final state only. If you bring these two metrics together, you obtain a generic Bolza problem, just understand an optimal control problem, with the objective function being in that form. The sum of one criteria for the final state plus n criteria for each of the intermediate state and controls. And you wish to minimize this. So we can write everything in a single form as an optimization problem, this one. We aim to solve this problem, this optimal control problem, which is actually nothing more than an optimization problem. You can see that we have two sets of variables, the states and the controls. We have a constraint which imposes to the state to follow the trajectory resulting from the control. We have the constraints that I explained above, and the objective function of the minimization of a final cost plus some midterm costs. So again, this is an optimization problem, so we can solve it easily using any algorithm from the literature. In this topic, we are interested in a very specific aspect of P when it has singularities. Let's start with an example. Consider a case where everything is smooth except the final term's cost, so the Meyer cost. This problem is non-smooth, so it cannot be solved by a Birth. But it also has many variables, so it cannot be solved easily by a derivative-free algorithm. However, if you investigate its structure, this problem is almost smooth. That is, everything here is smooth, except one function in the objective. So the objective, the ID, is to isolate the only state affecting this singularity and to address it separately from the everything else. So the interest of the reformulation is exactly this. In P, we optimize over everything at the same time, so it does not work easily. While in the reformulation, we focus on some states, some predefined states only, and leave everything else to their subproblem. So we have a bi-level structure where the main singular problem optimizes some checkpoint states, I would say, and the subproblem aims to find a trajectory linking those checkpoint states optimally. So we handle all the singularities in this small problem and keep all the smooth structure in this subproblem. So as I said, because of that, we can address the singularities easily in a small problem, solved with any derivative-free solver, for example, NOMAD. And this problem, which is smooth, is a classical optimal control problem with a fixed final state. So it can be solved by IPOPT or any algorithm from the literature. Okay, so this is the main idea. Now I will just do a little bit more of math to formalize the reformulation. We start with a subproblem. Let's say we have two times gamma and sigma, arbitrary, and two arbitrary states, x gamma and x sigma. We'll craft a subproblem trying to link x gamma at time gamma to x sigma at time sigma. And we aim to link these two states optimally. So this forms a subproblem, this subproblem written here. You can see that in this subproblem, we start from x gamma. We construct the trajectory coming from x gamma with the effect of u. And we aim to have the end state being x sigma. Everything is done at minimal cost. So once again, this subproblem aims to link the two states x gamma and x sigma at optimal cost. It recovers an optimal trajectory. Okay, as a side note, it may have no minimum or be infeasible, as I explained above. So in general, these difficulties are addressed easily. I won't discuss them here. And I will just write its optimal solution, if it exists, as S star. So now I have that, I can construct the reformulation. Let's say we can write several reformulations, in fact. The first one I show here is the one I explained above, where x n is the only variable of the main problem. So we minimize over x n. We minimize the last function, g, plus a subproblem. Again, the idea here is that you fix the last state first, and then consequently, you search for an optimal trajectory linking x0 to xn. So all this smooth aspect is hidden here, and here you have the possible singularities. Another example is when you have two states at the main problem. Let's say the final state xn plus the midterm state xn over 2. You can craft another reformulation using this. In that way, you minimize over the midterm state and the last term state. And the idea is in this problem, you have two subproblems. The first one connects x0 to xn over 2, and the second subproblem connects xn over 2 to xn. So once again, you have hidden all this smooth structure here. And this still recovers an optimal solution, that is an optimal trajectory, which has to join the states you impose at the upper level. So maybe you are starting to foresee how we can generalize this, because it can be generalized in a very easy thing, which is you predefine some states, which has to be the variables of the main problem. So let's say we craft lambda 1 to lambda p, which are the indices of the states left to the upper level. So you minimize over x lambda 1 to x lambda p. And then you craft the subproblems, each trying to connect one state, x lambda y, to the state after, x lambda y plus 1. And this can be used for any lambda. So in other words, you can choose which state you want as a checkpoint state. And this subproblem tries to connect all these checkpoint states you optimize at the upper level. So this is the generic reformulation we work on. And again, it is relevant because all of this is a specific case of the preliminary section I showed before. So it means that if you have an optimal solution of the reformulation, you can recover an optimal trajectory from the original problem, even if it has singularities. You just have to solve R lambda using NOMAD at the upper level to address the singularities, and use IP opt at the smooth lower level. Isaiah Piot or any other technique from the literature, obviously. So this idea sounds quite simple, but it works well. And again, I know that there is some theoretical drawbacks I showed above, but trust me, it is very easy to address numerically. You will see that on the computational study I'm going to show you. So we'll show three different kinds of problems. The first one is the harmonic oscillator I showed above. So we have the dynamics I showed before, and we aim to, let's say we aim to maximize the potential energy of a spring while minimizing the kinetic energy, all of this at the final time. So the objective is to ensure that at the final time, the spring is as far as possible from its equilibrium with no speed. And we aim to do all of this with minimal control. And just to ensure that we have a singularity, I truncated the potential energy such that rather than the displacement x, we have only the floor of the displacement. Okay, so what does it give? The results are just here. I show several trajectories. That is, the uncontrolled one is exactly what it says, how the system behaves with no control as a baseline. I show Hypiot, which is an attempt to solve the original problem with Hypiot alone. I show controls, which is an attempt to solve the original problem with Nomad alone. And I show two variants of the reformation with the final states only as variables, and the final and midterm states are as the variables. We obtain this. We can see on this graph that neither Hypiot nor Nomad solved the original problem. They remained at the uncontrolled trajectory, so this is very far from optimal. While the reformulation both worked well, they recovered the same optimal solution, and it is clearly more interesting than any attempt to solve P. So on this very simple problem, it seems that the reformulation is relevant and useful. It works well. Once again, it works well because there is a singularity on the original problem. So, well, we had to do something. And this reformulation does the job. But this is a very simple problem. How does it behave on a, let's say, harder one? I will show here two variants of a Zermelo problem. So in a word, what is it? Imagine you have a river defined that way, and you just put a boat on it, starting from the origin. The river has a stream defined by a function S, which pushes the boat towards the middle of the river. The boat has a motor delivering a driving force with unitary norm and tunable direction. So the control is not the magnitude of the force, it's only the angle. So the resulting dynamic is given here. As you can see, it depends on the stream and the driving force. Okay, so don't worry if you can forget the equation for now. Just focus on this graph, which shows the stream. So if we start from the origin and we don't apply any control, the boat follows this trajectory. As you can see, the stream is constructed so that the boat is repelled from the shore. And at the middle of the river, there is a huge stream, which is very powerful. And in fact, the driving force of the boat cannot overcome the stream at the middle of the river. So if you want to cross the river, you have to remind that at the middle of the river, you will face a huge stream. And this is what we will try to solve. The objective of this first problem is to cross the river, so to reach the upper shore. Because imagine there is a parking on the upper shore, and you aim to find a good parking spot, that is a parking spot on the right aspect of a river. The more you are on the left, the less interested you are. So we start from the uncontrolled territory and run all the algorithms. What do we see? First of all, IPOPT recovered a feasible trajectory because it reached the upper shore. But after that, it struggled to optimize the trajectory because of some singularities on the final state. So IPOPT is feasible, but far from being interesting. Nomad on the original problem is not good either. As you can see, it is not even feasible because the trajectory does not reach the upper shore at the final time. So once again, solving directly the original problem is not a good idea. We will have to work on the reformulation. And once again, the two reformulations perform equivalently because they reach the exact same final state. And as you can see, it is more on the right than the other two, so it is way more interesting. Once again, the reformulation performs way better than the original problem. Because, if I had to say it short, it satisfies the final time constraint, the boat is at the upper shore, and it reached a way better parking spot on the right aspect. So, another example where the reformulation works. I will also show another Zermelo problem, where this time we have two targets to reach. The first one is at the midterm, and the second one is at the final term. Imagine this as some kind of race where you have to reach the objective as close as possible, and your score is the sum of the distance. The targets are discretized, are singular, in the sense that if you are in a given plateau, you have the same objective value. So here, this plateau has a given objective value, and regardless of where you are in this plateau, the value is the same. So you do not aim to reach the exact center of the target, you aim to reach the plateau which is the closest to the center. So this one at the midterm, and this one at the final term. And in terms of results, well, first of all, this, as you can see, there is two singularities in this problem. One at the final state, the last targets, and another one at the midterm state. So here we have really two states affecting the singularities. So if we run all the algorithms, once again, IPOPT alone and Nomad alone fails, while the reformulation catches the idea of the problem. The reformulation working on the last problem, last state only, finds a slight improvement on the last target. As you can see here, the green curves is going toward the center of the last target, but it does not see anything from the midterm target. So this sounds logical because the singularity at the midterm is addressed via IPOPT in the first reformulation. So IPOPT does not see anything about the improvements. However, if we run the other reformulation, where the midterm state is also a variable of the main problem, then we recover a better solution. As you can see in the last curve, the other reformulation, so the reformulation with two variables, the midterm and last term states, finds an improvement on both the midterm targets and the last term targets. So here we see that when we craft the reformulation conveniently, so when we put all the singularities to the upper level via the reformulation, we clearly improve the trajectory. Because in this graph, only the last reformulation catches the general idea of the problem. The solution is not optimal. I can tell you that we can do better, but still, only one solution catches the idea. So this shows that the reformulation is relevant when you use it conveniently. We have to use some knowledge about the problem. Okay, but there is also one last problem that I want to show, which is a Lotka-Volterra system. So in a world, a Lotka-Volterra model is representing a biological reality. Assume that you have two species in an environment with infinite resources, and one of the species is a prey, and the other one is a predator. We will start from any number of individuals in each species and see how it works on the long run. If we want to add the control, we can think about a human intervention, such as hunting the predators. Okay, but with no human intervention, we have a cyclic behavior, which is actually easier to understand on this graph. Imagine this is the number of predators, and this is the number of prey in thousands. If we start here, we have few predators and few prey. As there is no predator, the prey can develop their species easily, so the number of prey grows a lot. At that, we reach ultimately that point. Here, we have very few predators and an insane number of prey. So the predator can hunt with no difficulty, so their species is developing, while the number of prey falls down. So we move, while reaching this point ultimately. After some years of hunting, the predators decimated almost all the prey. So there is few prey and several predators. At that point, the predators struggle to find some food, so they start to starve, so the number of predators falls down, while the number of prey remains low. And this concludes the loop. We come back to the original idea. So with no intervention, we will follow this loop indefinitely. The objective of the problem is to stabilize the system to its equilibrium toward 1-1. And we will do that only via hunting the prey with human intervention. The objective, once again, is to stabilize the system to its equilibrium at the final time with minimal number of predators hunted by human. If we run all of it, and I forgot to specify, the quality of the equilibrium of the stabilization is performed in a singular manner. Once again, we will craft some targets near the center, and the targets are crafted with plateau. So we do not reach exactly the center, we reach the plateau, which is the closest to the center. So as you can see here, we have several plateaus, and the optimal one is here. So in this problem, we see some surprising behavior. First of all, the classical one, neither hypiopt alone nor Neumann alone works, once again. But here, the reformulation working with the final state only does not work well. As you can see on this graph, the trajectory is far from being stabilized. And this is surprising, because in this problem, only the last state affects the singularities. So there is no reason a priori to justify why the reformulation working of the last state only failed. This had to be addressed, because this is the main problem. However, if we run the other reformulation, surprisingly, it works. It does not work optimally, but way better than the other. So what does that mean? In this problem, even if the singularity is located on the final state only, This is actually more interesting to optimize over the midterm state in addition to the last one. This is, well, not obvious, but actually I investigated and found an explanation, which is actually the biggest problem to address in the future work. Consider this. This is the infeasibility of any solution Xn in the first reformulation, Rn only. So on this graph, if you pick any x equal xy, you obtain an infeasibility as a measure. This infeasibility means if you aim to bring this solution into the subproblem, you obtain an infeasibility quantified that way. So if you are somewhere here, the same problem can find a trajectory joining this state. So the subproblem is feasible. If you are here at the center, the subproblem finds a solution, a trajectory joining x0 somewhere here to this solution. So you can join the optimal body. However, if you are somewhere in this band, the subproblem is numerically infeasible, which means that you cannot accept any final state in this band. So if you start from an initial guess here, you have an initial feasible solution. So the problem will try to move this final state somewhere in this square, starting from an initial feasible solution. So once again, you can move from here to there. It is a feasible move, so it will be accepted, but you cannot move from here to there because this solution is not feasible while this one is. So actually, the algorithm solving Rn only will remain here because it will detect that it is not interesting to go into this infeasible band. So even if the optimal solution is feasible, you cannot reach it because of the infeasible band before. And this infeasibility is only numerical. I have no theoretical explanation of that, because once again, the algorithm could have used the trajectory resulting from the other reformulation. So this is purely a numerical difficulty. And this shows that sometimes, because of that, it may be actually more interesting to use a more complex reformulation for purely numerical reasons. So overall, if I have to sum everything up, this talk in one frame is the following. We handle discrete optimal control problems with singularities or discontinuities in some of their costs. Usually, the singularities are affected by the states only. Solving the entire problem with Nomad does not work. Solving with HypeOpt does not work either. So we have to do something. The idea of the reformulation is to exploit both solvers' strengths. We optimize with Nomad the states affecting the singularities, and with HypeOpt, we search for a trajectory joining the states. The results are promising. We have seen before that the reformulation works. However, there is still some theoretical and practical difficulties to handle. Remind the last problem. So overall, my idea is for future work to use more intensively the structure given by the optimal control problem to craft a very specific instance of NAD, so any specific instance of a derivative-free algorithm to solve precisely this kind of problem. So optimal control problem with singularities affected by the states only. Maybe it could be more interesting because with such use of the structure, we can remove the problem I showed before with Rutger-Volterra systems. So this concludes my talk. And in one last word, I will just thank you for listening. And I will ask any question you have. Thank you.